Hey everyone, welcome to episode 57 of the Miami Tech Pod. I am Caesar. We got a full house tonight. We got Will, Brian, Maria, and returning guest alert, we got Michelle Abs, the founder of Web3 Equity. You know, she works with MetaGood. She's the queen of NFTs. Michelle, welcome back to the Miami Tech Pod.
Oh man, I didn't even know you had a chance to be a returning guest. This is such an honor. I love it. I love round two. Thanks for having me.
It's a small crew, I will say. We, you know, we don't offer that to everyone.
It's like a level of rarity in an NFT collection, right?
Exactly. Exactly. In the future, when the Miami Tech Pod has an NFT, that will be the way that you get back on through some type of, you know, one of like, I don't know, 12 NFT or something like that. Some pass.
I like it.
Scoop of mine. But you've had a lot going on. This is a big week for you. Why don't you share a little bit what you've been up to?
Yeah, so this week has been incredible. Actually started the week in Austin, Texas at South by Southwest. Flew back from that and on Wednesday morning hosted an event with Web3 Equity, the Venture Miami team, and TradeStation Crypto to usher in the Tuttle Tribe NFT collection. So we had a huge launch party at the Perez Art Museum. It was really, really incredible. And yeah, I mean, we, you know, we're riding off this momentum of educating and onboarding more women, male allies, non-binary into the Web3 space. And so the NFT collection unlocks that utility. And yeah, we just spent Wednesday morning enjoying like the celebration of that. And there it is.
So if you're not watching on YouTube, you're missing out. This thing looks sweet.
Very Miami vibes. I'm excited. I have mine too. I minted. Here's one adorable one with the Tuttle bridge.
Oh, you got the Tuttle. Those ones are really, those ones are, you know, the more rare ones, the features of Tuttle, Julia Tuttle, either the causeway or herself. So congrats, Maria. Got the minting lottery.
I thought it was because I know you, but I guess not.
Do we need to like explain to listeners who Julia Tuttle is, or is that like?
I think you should. So. I think we drive on that causeway quite frequently, but especially for folks that just moved to Miami, I think they might not know the Julia Tuttle Causeway because that kind of like where you first hear the name is that causeway, and some people just still refer to it as the 195, not to be confused with the I-95, which a lot of people get confused with. So yeah, I think it's worth it. Michelle, you want to give a primer on Julia?
Yeah, so
on Julia, love it.
Julia, I know. Yes, we are on a first name basis. I feel like I know her well. I channel her energy often. So Julia Tuttle is referred to as the mother of Miami. Miami is the only major U.S. city that was founded by a woman. So Julia Tuttle, back in the late 1800s, came down to Miami, bought, you know, some of the first pieces of land here. She's also really famous for brokering the deal with Henry Flagler to bring the Flagler, you know, train station to connect down to Miami, which is really what like catapulted the growth of Miami in the early 1900s. So we love Julia Tuttle. We love the fact that Miami was founded by a woman. And we think, you know, we wanted to lean into like embracing that feminine leadership, because I think we as a city and a community do that really well. So we wanted to honor her, you know, and share the way she inspires us, and also kind of spread the word to the rest of Miami that this is something we're super proud of, and we celebrate our mother of Miami and, you know, through this collection.
Are there any good books about Julia Tuttle that you come across that you'd recommend people read more about her? You know,
so it's interesting. I've learned a lot about her at the History of Miami Museum and from Dr. Dunn, who is a really famous historian. So I've learned a lot from sort of anecdotal and then a lot of reading online. I don't actually have like a core book that I recommend to folks. I mean, I think there's some great ones on like the history of Miami overall. And it should be noted that Julia Tuttle and Mary Brickell actually worked together. And, you know, there was a lot of similarities in their story. And so Mary Brickell, we also, you know, have a Mary Brickell Village in honor of her. And so her name has a nice stamp on Miami as well. But it's really cool that there's two women actually, you know, who were involved in that sort of inception, the foundation of Miami back not quite 150 years ago.
So Michelle, tell us about like the mechanics of launching an actual NFT project, right? I mean, I feel like I'm sure there were a few stories of sleepless nights here and like a bunch of, you know, stress, but it looks really, really awesome. And I encourage people, we'll put the link in the show notes here and of course on social, but, you know, give us a behind the scenes account because, you know, like Will Weinrob makes it look super easy. And yeah, my gut tells me it's not.
Yes, he does. And I think that's what going into it. I was like, oh yeah, this is easy. We can do this. I'm a huge fan of paradoxes. So I will say this was equal parts easy and equal parts the hardest thing I've ever done. So I don't want to scare anyone off. I think, you know, folks who are considering this, you should do this. It can be executed. And there it's an uphill road in some ways and you know, a lot of learning. So sort of the origin story of the group and how we even got to the place of launching an NFT, I think is important too. So this started out, this was a Telegram chat after hosting a conference in early December. I started getting a lot of messages, majority from female friends, around like, how do I get into NFTs, Michelle? And when things slowed down a bit over the holidays on Christmas Eve, actually I started a Telegram chat, put everyone in there just to answer some questions and provide some resources. And then that group grew. We wanted to meet in person. We had a dinner together. Then we had some really cool learnings where we broke out into small group sessions. We all brought our computers, created digital wallets, analyzed different NFT projects that we might want to get into. And so that's like the origin story of this. And our mayor, Francis Suarez, and the Venture Miami team said, this whole piece around education that you're doing, you know, Michelle, this is something we want to scale at a community level. So would you consider doing this as an NFT collection so that more folks can learn? And that was sort of the birth of the idea. And we said, yeah, sure, that sounds great. He said, I'd love to do it during Women's History Month. Oh, by the way, I'm gone for the last 3 weeks of the month. So you can do it on March 16th. So the timeline was quite expedited. And so I think like first disclaimer and asterisk is I think really having a timeline that's reasonable to ramp up is key. So we ended up ramping up. We had about 4.5 weeks to do this. I would suggest 6 to 10 weeks is a lot more comfortable if folks are considering creating their own NFT projects.
By the way, just disclaimer, like you said, I make it look easy. I still haven't launched my project yet and Michelle has launched hers. So like I'm trying to catch up with Michelle. It's not the other way around. So congrats, Michelle. It's seriously an epic launch. And I'm a happy holder. I'm max minted and then I minted another one, you know, with you when we linked up later that day at Cisneros. So I'm holding long term.
Wait, on that note, I want you to get into kind of more about what you get as part of kind of being a holder. But yep. You guys, I wanted to bring up that you not only did you have that in the morning, but then you and Will taught a whole course to a group at Cisneros. And so would love you guys to share that. And also, you know, if other people are interested in having you guys come to their company and kind of bringing their teams up to speed, make sure to shout that out.
Yeah. When are you guys launching a university? Like what's the deal? I feel like we accredited like straight up tuition. Like how are we doing this?
Yeah. I mean, Michelle, that as you guys know, she's an educator by background. So this is like the perfect intersection. We worked on this really great curriculum that Michelle put together for Cisneros, kind of like a Web3 workshop. So Michelle, you want to kind of give context on how that came about? And yeah, if there are other companies out there that want to get something similar, what we can provide.
Yeah, I mean, this is my jam. This is the thing I love, right? Now I get to merge the educator in me with my passion around Web3. And so what we did was we, you know, did an intake process, like try to understand what, where is the starting point of the group and what do they want to learn? And then I just love thinking about different modalities and ways that you can bring someone to learning something and turning that light bulb moment on when something clicks. And so, yeah, we, you know, of course, we had some fun with it and broke down like some of the fun Twitter crypto terms. We then got into like more of the nuts and bolts and some of the data. We did a data exploration around growth in the market trends overall. And then had a couple great speakers to contextualize like from the brand, media brand angle, and then from the creator angle, you know, what goes into some of these key strategic decisions in Web3. And then we ended with a case study and a really important video from a thought leader named Roham, who's the founder of Dapper Labs. And so, again, I think it's, you know, around like offering different ways for things to click for people, like different learning modalities. And instead of just, you know, someone in the front, like talking at a group of people. And so that's like the thesis too in the Web3 Equity Group and what the Tuttle Tribe NFT unlocks is it unlocks access to that learning content. And we offer the learning content for three segments, three sort of types of learning. So one is there is a women's only experience. There are sometimes, I think, when women in an affinity group need to feel like safe, like they, you know, can ask that what may feel like stupid questions, even though we don't believe in stupid questions, that we can ask those things to each other. So we have women's only experiences. We have co-ed experiences where we bring together the broader, you know, holder group. And then we have male ally programming. So I think, you know, shout out to Will, Caesar, and Brian, who truly have been allies, I think, to myself, to many other women, and, you know, very thoughtful around how to amplify female leaders in Miami. And I think there's a lot of other gentlemen who want to learn, like, how do I recognize some of these more gender nuanced moments? How do I lean into them? How do I, you know, like, step back in moments? How do I step forward in moments? It's a delicate dance. And so we wanted to offer some programming around that as well. So women's co-ed experiences and male ally programming are all unlocked when you hold one of these Tuttle Tribes. And we host them in Miami, of course, and across the nation at this point. So we have events in LA, Atlanta, New York. We just held one in Austin. So we want to make sure we're like bridging our Miami, you know, vibe and like what we mean by diving into Web3 throughout the rest of the US.
I love all the things that are like going on in this thing right now. And, you know, one of the things that's really exciting to me about this is like we're all still very early in Web3. You know, like the term is so like loosey goosey at this point, and it's like still like the first inning of this, right? And I only imagine what if, you know, what if similar organizations had existed, you know, at the beginning of Web 1, Web 2, you know, the PC industry 40 years ago, you know, because like, I mean, for the computer history nerds here, women were a critical piece of early computing, you know, whether it was, you know, Ada Lovelace, you know, helping build the first computer software and stuff like that, you know, to all through the 50s and 60s and stuff like that. But there wasn't that support mechanism and sort of not safe space, but safe space, you know, like where people could learn and find their tribe, you know. And so I love the fact that you guys are doing this and building a modern version of what the tribal support is, you know, the familial support. So like kudos, pat yourself on the back, Michelle. Like this is, you know, I think truly a useful initiative that's going to transcend, you know, geography and time, hopefully, you know. And so I'm really excited to see what else like you guys have down the pipeline. What I'm actually really curious about like right now is like how hard was it to put together an NFT collection? You know, what was there some software you guys used, you all used for this? Was there, you know, like, I think the idea of launching an NFT collection is overwhelming to most people, especially like not just artists, but like anybody who's a creator, right? You know, like, how do you go about creating all the different rarities? How do you go about putting it out there? You know, so if you could share a little bit about that, I'd love to hear a bit more.
Yes, yes. Let's break down like the process so we can kind of demystify what feels like this arduous thing. So I think the first step is defining the vision. Like, what do you want to communicate through a digital asset? And so we were pretty clear on that. That part I felt really strong about. So our collection is around three themes. One is female empowerment. Second is digital wealth. And third is Miami. And so what we did then, step two, is finding the artist to communicate that vision. Because I can say those words, but actually seeing those words and having those themes pop out to someone who's seeing them back, that's something an artist has to do. So we had an onboarding call. We actually spoke to a couple different folks around different ways we might approach this. We thought first we would do some calligraphy and writing. And so there were a couple things that, you know, we explored and then said that doesn't totally fit with the ethos. Then we met our wonderful artist, Amaranta Martinez, and we had an onboarding call with her, and she listened. She asked a lot of questions and she listened a lot. And from there, she said, okay, I think, you know, I've got, you know, what you're telling me, I'm going to create one image to reflect back what I think, where I think we can go. And we loved what she created. And from there, then we said, okay, what are the elements of this that, so then I would move into step three now. So like step two is finding the artist and then finding that like first, like signature piece. And then from there, now what are the things that we can play with on the layers that then allow us to have some rarity and differentiation to actually create a collection that has the volume and the scale? We have 3,050 pieces in our collection. And so as we were going through that step, what we realized was we loved the female image that we were capturing with the sunglasses on, and the, you know, different reflection in the sunglasses. But we said this whole female empowerment theme could come through even stronger if we were showcasing that as more women are onboarding into this space, we become more confident around these terms, and we become thought leaders and we vocalize that. So then we actually added a whole piece to our collection that we call the bocas, which stands for the mouths. And within the mouths, you see different keywords that we find in Web3. And so the idea was then, again, back to the theme that we defined in step one, you know, what the collection was about. But then is there another way that we could actually visually communicate that? And so we added in this bocas, which allowed us to play even more with the different traits and the rarity. And then from there, it's making sure that that is then communicated on the blockchain. So, you know, finding the artist, like that whole process that we just kind of walked through. And then there's on the developer side, and making sure that the back end will actually execute the contract on the blockchain in the way that the artist has created it. And so, you know, finding the right developer, making sure they also understand that. And then the entire process of testing and doing test runs of each of the types of rarity that we thought might work. And then, oh, you know what? This color hair doesn't work with this headband. You can't do this hair with these earrings because it does, you know, so like doing the editing and fixing, I think that's, you know, the final phase really leading up to launch day.
And so for those who feel like they missed out, they did not, right? We still have a chance to mint.
That's correct.
Yeah. So can you tell anyone kind of how they can get more involved? And also, I think you guys have a kind of a sponsor corporate component to it. So if folks want to kind of do a big, make a bigger impact by via the organization, can you share a little bit about that?
Yes, for sure. So first of all, we should define the term minting. So actually someone came up to me after the launch day and they said, okay, but you keep saying minting, can I buy one? And so minting is actually the first purchase of a digital asset. And this is like a light bulb moment for me. Think about like the US mint, right? Where currency is created and dollars are printed. That's what we mean by minting. It's like that first moment when you know, a dollar is printed or a digital asset is printed is the minting moment. So minting is happening and you can buy the NFTs now. And what's fun about minting is that it is a bit of a lottery. You are, you know, clicking mint and then you find out after you mint which image you got. And so that process is happening now. You can buy as an individual. And we also are working with larger groups, organizations, corporations who want to offer the utility and learning experience to their employees. So similar to, you know, what we did with the Cisneros group, if you know, corporations are looking to say, hey, staff, we know you're asking these questions and you want to learn more. We'll offer you, you know, a training in person and this NFT that unlocks the future trainings and all of the utility from there. So, you know, we have that package and that's more, you know, one-on-one. So I'm happy to talk to people if they have questions and want to get involved at that level.
That's excellent. Michelle, you have such a good talent for explaining this stuff. I just want to say that on the podcast because it is like a very complicated world that I feel like turns people off. And at first glance, the average person's like, what's an NFT? It's like a bunch of nerds that have like all of these like slang words that I don't really know. And it could be, you know, intimidating, right? Like in the entire space. And, you know, it's definitely like in the middle of pop culture right now, right? It's, you know, like very hard to imagine someone who hasn't heard, you know, what an NFT is and all that. But like, how much we all kind of understand that we're in the very early innings of this, but like, how much do you think that the communities like slang and lingo and like, you know, private WhatsApp groups and all of that actually does a disservice to mass adoption?
Yeah, I think a lot about this. I think a lot about the like current sort of structures or like template that's in place that sometimes I think we just blindly follow. I personally have had, you know, after launch day, I said, darn, you know, we ended up doing a pre-sale list, like a certain amount of wallets that were allowed to mint the NFT first. And as we were at the event, I was like, wait, everyone here should be able to mint this. But because it's just kind of the way that I've seen things done so far, I was like, oh yeah, that's just what we do. But we really are so early right now that I think everyone is you know, called to examine it, the things that we do and why we do them and do they make sense for everyone? Because the answers to some of those things are, well, no, it made sense when we did it before because, you know, it was this context or, you know, whatever the details around that particular example were. But actually, maybe at scale, this doesn't really make sense. We've sort of had this number of 10,000, right? Well, we were talking about this the other day. Collections that are larger, usually around 10,000. Well, why? Like, does that make sense? Is there a world where maybe we get to a point where there are collections that are 100,000 or collections that really focus much smaller? And so I think that we are called to ask these hard questions right now, because what I don't want to see is us accidentally stumble into a world where we create a system or a process that does leave people out. And we've seen that happen in different technological advancement moments in the past. And I think that's what we all want to avoid. And I feel really grateful that many folks on this call and folks in the tech world have been very, you know, thoughtful, held my hand in my onboarding. They've been inclusive. And so that's really what I think we have to do with the current setup of, you know, onboarding to make sure we get to the point of mass adoption.
Yeah, I love that ethos, Michelle. And I think, again, that's one of the things that I respect so much about this project. And frankly, you know, one of the things that I respect about you, you know, one of the top things that I respect. I respect a lot of things about you, but one of the main things is just how much you care about upbringing everyone around you and rising everyone. Like, you're a very selfless person. You care a lot about the community and making sure everyone feels involved and included, and that these moments that are happening, let's say for Miami as a whole, one, but then in just Web3 and NFTs as an industry, as a sector, two, these are big rising tide lifts all ship moments, and you're making sure everyone has a boat. And I really, really appreciate that. And I really respect that about you. This is a space that, as we just talked about, unfortunately started around exclusivity, right? And it started around, you know, are you in the know? Do you have enough crypto? Do you know the right people? Like, can you get into this? Are you whitelisted, right? Are you on the right list? These are like digital velvet ropes. And I think what you're doing with Web3 equity and all the projects and the initiatives that you're spearheading is about just removing all the velvet ropes and breaking down all those barriers. So I just want to commend you for all that work. It's really, really important. And I know you're changing a lot of lives in the process. So hats off to you. And if you're listening to this and you don't have a Tuttle Tribe NFT and you nodded your head at any point during the last 30 minutes, go to the website. We'll drop the link in the description. Make sure you mint an NFT, because if you stand for some of the things we just talked about, this should definitely be in your wallet.
I love it. I think it's important to add too that, you know, we wanted to price this in a way that, you know, connects to the utility it unlocks. Again, this is access to educational programming afterwards. That's truly where the cost goes. Like, we're taking all that back, and then that goes to fund the pieces of learning that will come after. But this is priced at 0.05 Ethereum, which today's ETH market is around $140. So I don't know a lot of other places where you can get this much learning and training at that price tag, right? Like, there are a lot of courses, it's $1,000 to get into. There are, you know, degrees you get that are much more expensive than that. So yeah, I hope that folks mint and become part of the tribe and feel this love of the community and get the utility of the learning experience, which to me, that price, you know, in terms of what the value that you end up getting, I think is really compelling.
Yeah. And by the way, folks that are listening also that maybe heard some of them be like, oh, I think I know a lot about NFTs already. I don't need that, et cetera. Well, this makes a great gift for someone, right, that wants to get into the space. So if you're listening to this and you feel like you're pretty well versed, mint an NFT and transfer it to someone that wants to learn more. I mean, what a great gift to throw this in someone's wallet that's just starting out. Be like, hey, I just gifted you all this education and access through the program. So if you're thinking about loved ones in your life that could use some of this education and programming, mint one, gift one. I think that would be an amazing gift for folks that are looking to jump into the space.
You know, let's circle back. There was a topic that you guys both touched on a second ago, which was like, you know, we keep doing things because that's how we've always done them, you know, and like we have these like exclusivity and mint lists and or white lists or whatever and all that, you know, so much of that is like borrowed from the existing industries that we knew or that like that we felt were like analogous to this, right? Like the art industry, everything is only valuable because it's exclusive, right? And Web3 is really interesting to me in the sense that like the economics of it all is so new and it's so so novel, and that we can change how we finance projects, how we sustain projects, you know, like the built-in smart contracts functionality is like game changing. You know, I mean, look at Bored Apes. They've made more money from resales than they ever did from the original minting, you know? But then that, like that sort of puts the project owners in this like weird sort of dilemma where like you want to have exclusivity so that there's resale value, but then you also want to have accessibility, right? And so I'm really curious your thoughts, Michelle, and like how do you balance the two? Because like you could in theory release a 40,000 or 100,000 or infinite number size project, or you could be doing a series of every month there's a new set of 3,050, you know, or whatever the number is, you know, and so there's different collections, you know, and so on, right? You could do the Celia Cruz collection or whatever it is, right? You know, different interesting women in our culture, you know, who've been trendsetters, right? But like, what are your thoughts on like, how do you balance that sort of the the marketplace desires versus the accessibility desires?
This is such a great question. And honestly, this is why I love working in Web3. I think, Will, you posted this a few days ago on Twitter. It's like, if anyone tells you they're an expert in this space, run. And Caesar, you were, you know, sharing this concept around these sort of walled gardens, and it feels like, oh, techies, and they know everything. And how do we break this down? In Web3, it is okay to say, I don't know yet, and I want to figure that out. Like, I want to lean into playing with this. Like, how do we figure this out? So there, this collection of the Tuttle Tribes, which, you know, is the Genesis collection, the first collection, is 3,050. And Brian hits the nail on the head. It's like that's a small exclusive number. Is that really, if our entire ethos is around educating and onboarding, you know, more people to Web3, that probably needs to be a much larger number. So how do we get to a place then also, you know, on the back end, how do we make sure that we can deliver the educational content? You know, how do we lean into maybe some of the metaverse platforms and the spaces where we can deliver more virtual content and give people the feeling of the in-person content? So this is something that we have to explore, and we have to explore the continued like collaborations and partnerships, right? So maybe that's not all on our collection to do. That is, you know, partnering and working with other groups there. Thankfully, there's a lot of collaborative efforts, especially around, you know, this onboarding and access piece. And we've had some great conversations with the My BFF team. You know, they've got some very notable celebrities who are part of that. And we're very lucky in Miami that their community manager is here locally. So Christine has been incredible. And so exploring partnerships with other folks. But the short answer, Brian, is that I don't know yet. And that's what I love about this. And that's what I invite others into this is let's help figure this out. We've got this first collection and there's opportunity to explore different ways as we grow.
No, I think that's awesome. And I'm with you that I think to me, the Web3 sentiment right now is akin to like early web stuff back in Web2, Web1, you know, when everyone was learning together. You know, and I'd love to see some sort of mechanism at some point where your holders, you know, and your learners, right, for lack of a better word, could then resell their token or whatever, and then make money, you know, like, and then someone else can continue the learning process, you know, or recoup some of their investment, you know.
I wish that's how public education worked. Where I can like just
I'm willing to sell a portion of my undergraduate degree to UVA to anyone exactly. Here.
Now
I've gotten so much use out of my international relations degree.
Yeah, the humbling moment is going to be the value of that. I don't know what you know UF political science degrees trade for these days, but you know we'll find out. All right, Michelle, thank you so much for joining. Is there anything else? This is the plug piece of the episode. You know, like, don't hold back. Where can people mint the Tuttle Tribe project? I mean, just like lay it out here before we wrap, and then we'll move to some closing thoughts here.
All right. So yeah, the main call to action is to mint, be part of the tribe with us. The website is tuttletribe.web3equity.io. If that's too long to remember, the other call to action is find us on social. We're, you know, active on Twitter, on Instagram. We are at Web3, the number equity. We also have a Discord that is growing, and you know, that's a tool that we use to communicate a lot in Web3. And so if you've not jumped into our Discord, join in there. And if you want to just learn more about the project before you mint, any of those entry points will allow you to see the different events that we have coming up, the learning experiences, the virtual learning. But main thing you want to do is join. The five of us are all part of the tribe. There's over 1,200 people that are part of the tribe. So get in on this, learn with us, spread the knowledge and wealth of knowledge in Web3 so that we make sure everybody participates in the growth and the upside of what we're building right now. So go mint that Tuttle Tribe.
That's the mic drop moment. Thank you so much, Michelle, for joining. We can't wait.
And how can people get in touch with you, Michelle, if they are interested in some of the kind of learnings, either at a corporate level or sponsorship level? Or
yeah, I think the best way to do that, either through Twitter. I feel like I spend most of my days on Twitter. If folks are on there, they can DM. Or on our website, there is a contact us portion as well, and I'll follow up with that via email. And before we close out, I have to really give a huge hug to this team and to all of Miami, because Wednesday morning, Miami Tech showed up, right? Like we have been building this movement, and we've been a group of friends and collaborators for over a decade now. And that was such an incredible moment just to see everyone come out that morning in support of the launch of this. And so thank you so much. Like our Miami Tech Life team and Miami Tech Pod crew, that's like some real trust and support that's been built over the years. And so like just huge hugs and gratitude to everybody.
What a great episode. Thank you again for joining, Michelle. We will track your success here, and we look forward to having you back. The even more exclusive club is the third returning guest, which I don't think we've had. So, you know, something to look forward to.
I'll cook up something cool to get that third time that we'll have to talk about something great.
Awesome. All right, everyone. We will be with you next week with an exciting episode. Thanks for tuning in.